Just as a reminder, in preparation for our Mass, you can look at the readings on page 1072. So if you like to put a little ribbon there, 1072.
Our entrance hymn is in your additional music guide. That's that white pamphlet that you have used. Page 2, Come to the Feast. Almighty God, have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Thank you.
pray. Almighty and merciful God, graciously keep from us all adversity, so that unhindered in mind and body alike, we may pursue in freedom of heart the things that are yours. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. A reading from the first book of Kings. In those days, Elijah the prophet went to Zarephath. As he arrived at the entrance of the city, a widow was gathering sticks there. He called out to her, "Please bring me a small cupful of water to drink." She left to get it, and he called out after her, "Please bring me along a bit of bread." She answered, "As the Lord your God lives, I have nothing baked. There is only a handful of flour in my jar and a little oil in my jug. Just now, I was collecting a couple of sticks to go in and prepare something for myself and my son. When we have eaten it, we shall die." Elijah said to her, "Do not be afraid. Go and do as you propose. But first, make me a little cake and bring it to me. Then you can prepare something for yourself and your son. For the Lord, the God of Israel, says, 'The jar of flour shall not go empty, nor the jug of oil run dry, until the day when the Lord sends rain upon the earth.'" She left indeed as Elijah had said. She was able to eat for a year, and he and her son as well. The jar of flour did not go empty, nor the jug of oil run dry, as the Lord had foretold through Elijah. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Christ did not enter into a sanctuary made by hands, a copy of the true one, but for heaven itself, that he might now appear before God on our behalf. Not that he might offer himself repeatedly, as a high priest enters each year into the sanctuary with blood that is not his own. If that were so, he would have had to suffer repeatedly from the foundation of the world. But now, once for all, he has appeared at the end of ages to take away sin by his sacrifice. Just as it is appointed that human beings die once, and after this, the judgment, so also Christ, offered once to take away the sins of many, will appear a second time, not to take away sin, but to bring salvation to those who eagerly await him. The word of the Lord.
Teaching, Jesus said to the crowds, "Beware of the scribes who like to go around in long robes and accept greetings in the marketplaces, seats of honor in the synagogues, and places of honor at banquets. They devour the houses of widows and as a pretext recite lengthy prayers. They will receive a very severe condemnation." He sat down opposite the treasury and observed how the crowd put money into the treasury. Many rich people put in large sums. A poor widow also came and put in two small coins worth a few cents. Calling his disciples to himself, he said to them, "Amen, I say to you, this poor widow put in more than all the other contributors to the treasury. For they have all contributed from their surplus wealth, but she from her poverty has contributed all she had, her whole livelihood." The Gospel of the Lord. Think for a moment, imagine yourself there at this moment with Jesus. He's just sitting there kind of watching people, right? Sometimes people will talk about how they like to people watch, right? You sit there with your latte and just watch people walk by. So Jesus is just sitting there kind of watching people by the treasury. And so he has this, if you will, interaction, or at least this visual interaction with this poor widow, and he's watching her. And so I have one question for you as you sit there with Jesus. And you observe that he's saying that she just put in everything that she has at that time. Was she sad or was she happy? Was she distressed or was she at peace? You see, Jesus is sitting there, not just observing actions, he's reading people. He's reading their souls. If we ever were to fall into a false sense of faith, to think that the things inside our souls somehow are distant from Jesus, that would be a mistake. He can read our souls all the time. He knows what we hope for. He knows what we put our faith in. He knows what we live for, what we're willing to die for. Sometimes it's good, sometimes it's not. But he understands us. I've been reading a book lately. It's not really a spiritual book per se, but it's actually really impacting me in ways I hadn't really perceived. So it's a book written about the process of the Vatican actually discovering the remains of St. Peter buried under St. Peter's Basilica. They tried to excavate back in the 13th century looking for St. Peter's remains, and they didn't find it. They tried again, I think it was in the 18th century, and they didn't find it. But they kept it all a secret because they were kind of embarrassed by the fact that they couldn't find St. Peter's remains. From our writings of the different saints, they knew they were there because that's where they built the basilica for that reason. So, actually, during World War II, it was right before the war, they decided to start again, looking for the remains. And they needed some funding, so they actually found an American. He was an entrepreneur who became very wealthy from discovering oil in Texas. He was one who loved his faith deeply. And so when the Vatican asked him to support them, he basically said, "I'll give you whatever you need." And so they began the process of excavating farther under the basilica. So they hired an archaeologist. He was a priest. Back then, they would joke about archaeology, how it was two forms. One were the treasure hunters. And in this book, they just to put a visual on it, they said kind of like Indiana Jones, which back in the 1930s, 40s, and 50s was a reality. Many archaeologists were looking for something that they could bring back to their museum. They said they were just one step higher than a grave robber. The other archaeologists that were becoming more and more prominent were the scientists. They were the ones who would go in and spend years studying something and then leave it. They wanted to understand the people, how they live, their minds, their hearts. So this first archaeologist that they hired or had with this priest, he was a little more of a treasure hunter. And so they started excavating underneath the basilica, and he didn't really understand a lot of the symbolisms or the significance of things. And so many things were destroyed that would actually eventually be necessary to find the grave, the tomb of St. Peter. Well, through the course of time, it was made public that they were looking for these remains, and there was another archaeologist, and she kind of caught wind of it, and she was a little different. She was more of the scientist type. And they asked her to help because they were having trouble. And so she was tenacious. She was just this pit bull. She would go down into these tunnels, into these excavation sites, every single day and just study what she would see. In the evenings when she couldn't be down in the excavation site, she would just pore over photographs of them. She was obsessed over figuring this out. The thing with her is that it wasn't just a study to find some treasure. She said it was the delight in coming to know a community of believers, the Christians, who lived 2,000 years ago. It was because of her they eventually would find the remains. But she talks about the process. They would excavate into these very old cemeteries where many people who were buried were not Christian at all. In fact, it was illegal to be Christian or Catholic. And so the Christians actually had to put codes. They had to put writings and things that no one else would even understand or suspect so that they could mark their graves and they could also communicate with each other. They compared it as kind of like in prison, where prisoners would develop a code to be able to communicate with each other. Well, that's what it was like for the Christians. She talks about some of the simple symbols that they would use, symbols that we take for granted. You've seen them, the Chi Rho. It looks like a backwards P with an X over it. Those are just the two first letters of the name for Christ. But nobody else would have caught on to that. In the cemetery, you could have a name, which everybody would suspect or just take for granted, but then after that they would put an alpha and an omega behind it, symbolizing Jesus Christ, the beginning and the end, the first letter and the last letter of the Greek alphabet. But all the Christians knew what that meant. If you saw an M or an MA, just graffitied, etched into stone somewhere, it was a sign for the Christians because it was Mary's name, for St. Mary. A T was a cross, an R represented resurrection, a V was for victory. She would go on to take all of this in, and she was able to read the hearts and the minds of the people in the community that lived 2,000 years ago. Jesus today, he's sitting there and he's reading people as they go by. I think there's something very powerful about this moment when Jesus identifies this poor widow. He's doing what he often always does. He takes the faith and he shows us how to take the world and turn it on its head. And almost to think about things reverse of what we'd be inclined to. Have you ever run a business? Right? If you want your business to succeed from an earthly perspective, the widow's mite means nothing. It's valueless. So Jesus is observing things differently. Now, let's go back to the Basilica of St. Peter for a moment, but we're going to go back to the 13th century. So imagine you're sitting outside St. Peter's Basilica, and there's a gentleman who is sitting out there also with his cappuccino, right? Just watching people go into St. Peter's Basilica. Now, at the time, people would make donations. They would drop their coins into these large grates that you would walk over, and the coins would fall through the grates, and at the end of the day, they would come and collect the donations. So he's watching people, and this man's kind of wealthy. He's had life fairly easy. His father was a very successful businessman. Life was good. But he slowly becomes incensed. He becomes angry because he watches people, and he's trying to read them, and he looks at their appearance, and he looks at how much they're donating. And he thinks that they're all cheapskates, that they should be donating more. And in this anger, he takes all of his money that he has on him, which was a very large sack of coins, and he throws it through the crowd, and it lands on these grates and makes a big scene. And he walks off in disgust. Now, you know who this guy is. This was St. Francis of Assisi before he was a saint. This is him before he's learned how to read souls, how to learn to read people, or even his own soul, the way Jesus does. He was looking at people superficially, arrogantly, and just judging, condemning them. A few years later, he would be very different. And so we sit with Jesus as he sees this poor widow. Now, a young boy came up to me after Mass, and he said, "Father, what is a widow?" So, just in case we have anybody here who doesn't know, so a widow would be generally a woman who's a little bit older, her husband's already passed away, and so back then, one of the major struggles was widows would often struggle with being destitute, being poor, because they would be losing their income from the work of their husband. So she comes in on the scene. Now, before we get to her, I want to look at the first part of the gospel, because this is important. This gives us a key to how to read Jesus' mind and his heart. So he says, "Beware of the scribes," okay, "who like to go around in long robes." "And accept greetings in the marketplaces." Well, if we're talking about Home Depot, check. Okay. "Seats of honor in synagogues," check. "Places of honor at banquets." Now, I personally despise that, but pretty much any time I'm invited to a banquet, they'll always try to put me at the head table, and I try to sneak back into the back. But I would say, check. "Devour the houses of widows?" Thankfully not. However, in our beloved church, the church that we give our lives to and we love dearly, we even forget that when we want to create something from God, we forget what foundation to lay. And we, like everybody else, become tempted to not look at the poor widow, but to look at money or things as being necessary. Jesus is going to teach us that faith, hope, and charity is actually the true wealth that we need. The last one, "Recite lengthy prayers," check. Now, this doesn't look good for priests, as he says they will receive very severe condemnation. There's a quote from St. John Chrysostom, who lived in the 4th and 5th century, and he had a great quote. He was a priest and a bishop, and he said, "The floor of hell is carpeted with the skulls of priests." That's a cheery thought. I'll leave that with you for this week. And then he said that bishops would, the remains of bishops would mark the way to hell. Why would he say that? Because we often forget, and we have great responsibility to lead people to heaven. Now, within all that negativity, there's actually a very, very important item in there. For Jesus Christ, the ability to greet another person, the ability to recognize another person is tied to honor. Honor is very important. Corruption is when we honor the wrong people. And so who does Jesus honor today? Who does he greet, in a sense, with just his mind and his heart? Now we begin to understand what is important. If you look at this poor widow, it says that she gives out of her poverty. For our ability to be able to be comfortable and able to give out of our weakness, not necessarily out of our strength, and even in our strength, to be able to use so much of our strength that it actually becomes a weakness. She gave everything. Now, it might be easy to say, well, she had virtually nothing, so it's really not that hard. I think that would be a mistake, because possession, materialism, is a state of mind, not necessarily a quantity of goods. She was free. She was free of anxiety. She was free to give completely. She is embodying in this moment the virtue of charity. She's trusting God, so she's embodying in this moment the virtue of true faith, right? I've talked about this the last couple of weeks. True faith is manifested in our actions every single day. That's true faith. And I would add hope, because someone like her in this moment is trusting that what little she has will be used by God for something great. That is hope. I think these things are important to keep in mind. The very nature of us as a community to be able to honor that which should be honored. Now I want to start, on at least on this sense, with the fact that in pretty much every Catholic church, we struggle with this, and that's honoring our neighbor. When we come to Mass and we don't know our neighbor, we fail to honor them. The sign of a true Catholic community is one that actually knows each other, loves each other, and actually works together. That's where honor is. Now, I want you to think for a moment, if you know, you don't have to look around right now, but do you know some of the people around you? It's not fair if they're family, okay? But people who are not part of, let's say, your daily life, and you only see here at church, do you know at least their name? Now, I bring this up knowing that when we as priests get together, we try to come up with solutions, and we just do not have a clue what's actually missing. So we say, well, let's give our prisoners name tags, right? Then we can remind ourselves every single weekend that we are not community. We don't even know each other's names, okay? So that's not necessarily the answer. A lot of times priests, before Mass, they'll have everybody stand up and greet each other and talk to each other. I've never liked that, because I always felt like it was turning the church, God's house, into a tavern. And I don't think that's necessarily helpful, but it is a sign that we are failing to demonstrate true honor for each other here as brothers and sisters in Christ. So I'm putting it on you to think about, and to at least attempt, in very quiet ways. When you come into church, I want you to greet the people who sit near you. You don't even have to use words. It could just be a wave, it could be just eye contact. But it's a way to recognize the dignity of the fact you are sitting next to another child of God who's here to worship. All right? Now, if you're like me, you're an introvert, this is kind of against our nature. We would rather not necessarily do that. This is important for the first step in recognizing the dignity of the people around us. The Catholic Church challenges our world constantly about protecting the dignity of people, unborn, born, elderly, any different race, culture, how important it is for us to do that. But then we come to church and we don't even know each other. There's a serious breakdown there. And so I want us to be, now, as I say this, I also want to keep in mind this. St. Mary's actually is much better than a lot of other communities I've been in. We do have a lot of things going for us as a community, and we do a lot of work together, and so that's all great. I'm just inviting us to be able to take it to that next level. So, in a very quiet, respectful way of people praying, is to recognize each other's existence when we come in. right? A smile, the eye contact, a wave, whatever it may be. And as we slowly get to know each other, we also even take on maybe some ministries where we work with each other. I think that's important. In saying this, is recognizing that the little things that sometimes we try are artificial, and they're just signs to us that we're actually not really the community Jesus desires, not quite yet. So we keep working on it. The other thing that came to me in this is the fact that Jesus is even just sitting there. He's sitting there watching people. He has 3 years of his life to get the Catholic Church started, right? To establish this faith. 3 years to do that. You would think that he would have 5 secretaries and administrators and executives, and he would be running around with his cell phone ringing all the time. And he's sitting there just watching people. So the next thing, a little challenge here. If we're too busy for Jesus, then we have already sinned. I want to put out there a new type of sin for us as Americans. If we are too busy for love, we are sinning. If we are too busy for faith, we are sinning. If we are too busy for hope, we are sinning. I'm not saying this to make us all feel bad, but for us to recognize what is most important. When Jesus built the church, what he did was he built a place for faith, hope, and charity to grow and to be passed on. And there's many different ways that we do that as Catholics. But if we're too busy, then it dies. Now, this came into my mind just the other day because I realized I haven't talked about it in a while. This building here is for you to be able to spend time with him, right? It's open 24 hours a day if you know the code. Now, you would probably never find another parish that allows its parishioners to come into the main church 24 hours a day. I believe, though, having faith that this is worth it. There's a risk here that's worth it. I've never been burned by it. I've never had somebody get the code who shouldn't have had the code. Please don't give the code to somebody who shouldn't have the code, okay? But if you don't know what the code is, you can ask me, you can ask the parish staff. What I want is for you to be able to come and to do what Jesus is doing. He comes and he honors us. If we are not here, then we fail to honor him. You don't have to be here 24 hours a day, but he waits for us. I often tell people in confession, when I ask them, do you pray every day? And especially like teenagers and youth, and say, well, not really. And then I ask them, do you think Jesus wants to talk to you every day? And without hesitation, they always say yes. A lot of us live somewhere here in this area. You pass by this church or you pass by other churches. I want you to consider being able to give Jesus a little bit of time where you just sit with him. Just to sit with him. There's a little story from St. John Vianney. He was talking with one of his parishioners, and he asked the man, he says, why do you come to the church every day? And the man said, well, when I come, I look at Jesus, and he looks at me. He defined friendship right there. That's friendship with the eternal God. Jesus is kind of doing that today in the gospel. He honors us, and so we should honor him back. And so what I've just talked about in this is loving God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and loving your neighbor as yourself. This is perhaps a little more practical way for us to be able to do that, and for ways as a community we can grow in that. Once again, though, we're all too busy. We've all allowed ourselves to become too busy. Jesus was never in a rush anywhere, to go anywhere. And so we find that to be able to reestablish our life to be more like His, where we have time for faith, hope, and charity. Together we say, I believe in one God,
Father Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten and not made, consubstantial with the Father.
The widow in the temple gave everything she possessed to God. Her generosity humbles us. Let us be generous in our prayers for others, responding to God who gives without ceasing.
For a better appreciation of the many words of charity and service carried out by the church, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the men and women who plan and administer the economy, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those whose giving is a real sacrifice, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For true gratitude in our hearts for the gift of Jesus Christ in this Eucharist, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all kids struggling with their schoolwork, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the dead who long for the company of Mary and all the saints, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Most generous Lord, receive the prayers of this community, offering themselves in union with the great High Priest, your blessed Son, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Thank you.
may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father. Look with favor, we pray, O Lord, upon the sacrificial gifts offered here, that celebrating in mystery the passion of your Son, we may honor it with loving devotion through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Lord be with you.
And with your
lift up your hearts.
Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For you so love the world that in your mercy you sent us the Redeemer to live like us in all things except sin, so that you might love in us what you loved in your Son, by whose obedience we have been restored to those gifts of yours that by sinning we have lost. And so, Lord, with all the angels and saints, we too give you thanks, as in exaltation we acclaim. He took a bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." Supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." We offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you've held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Accordingly, we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity. Together with Francis, our Pope, and Paul, our Archbishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection. So we just remember all those whom we know who have passed away. And all who have died in your mercy, welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Saint Joseph, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who please you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs of eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you all. Let's offer each other a sign of our Lord's peace. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Let us pray. Nourished by the sacred gift, O Lord, we give you thanks and beseech your mercy, that by the pouring forth of your Spirit, the grace of integrity may endure in those your heavenly power has entered through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated for just a moment. We have a couple things that we're just starting in our parish, so we're announcing them for the first time today, so that's why I was going to have you be seated. It's going to take about a minute or five. So we're offering a new Bible study that will be starting on Saturday mornings. It's going to fall the liturgical year, so that means it'll start November 27th, but we're going to have sign-up sheets in the back, so if you'd like to be part of it. So again, Saturday morning, so a lot of people are a little more available Saturday mornings if you would like to do it. It'll be a video Bible study with discussion, so if you're interested, you can sign up. If you don't see it today, it'll definitely be there next weekend. St. Mary's and Knights of Columbus are working together to actually provide an Advent wreath making event that will be... don't have the date actually. That will be coming up at the end of November also. So families, if you'd like to just come, you can make a wreath together, use it in your home for Advent, for prayer. We will also be providing dinner, just a very informal dinner. I believe it's pizza on that evening. We do want people to sign up so we know how many families to anticipate. Okay? So the sign-up sheets are in the back for that. The boxes of joy are finally here, but because they came very late, we need them back next Sunday. So this week, you get 7 days to put the items in the box. There's brochures that tell you what to do, what to put in them. So please do that. There's a lot of kids throughout the world who don't have the things that we have, and so this becomes a way for us to give to them. We are going to be doing a photo directory for the parish. We wanted to do it now so that when you have your pictures taken, if you want to use them for your Christmas pictures, you can do that. So beginning next Sunday, we have a photographer who will be here in the hall, and you don't need to sign up, you don't need to make reservations, but just after the masses, your family can go in there and have their picture taken. We are not using one of those professional photo directory services which charge you like $200 for a package of pictures. The gentleman we're hiring is very reasonable. It's $15 to $30 for each package, depending what you would like. You don't have to get a package, but you just have your picture taken, then it'll be in our new photo directory. The photo directory is a great way to learn people's names also, and to pray for our fellow parishioners. St. Joseph House is continuing their fundraiser of the poinsettias and wreaths, so there's little brochures on that on the back table. The Hispanic community wanted to do something to help the parish with regards to our expenses for our facilities upgrades. So they're hosting a tamale sale, tamales. So today, you can just go right out the side door here and there'll be somebody accepting orders. And then those orders will be ready on Saturday, November 20th. So if you'd like to do that, participate in that, you can just outside sign up for a order of tamales. St. Vincent de Paul today is doing their collection for their Christmas hygiene kits for the homeless in the area. The envelopes are in your pews if you'd like to put a little donation in, and then just drop it off in the basket as you exit. We're going to be, okay, a little over halfway there, right? We're going to be doing a men's consecration to St. Joseph through this Advent. So it's actually 6 weeks. We have a book that'll be our guide. We're going to be meeting every Saturday morning at 7:30 for 6 weeks in preparation for that. The books are free. Everything is free. We're going to do it in English and in Spanish. So if you'd like to sign up so we just get a sense of how many guys are interested, the sign-up sheet is in the back of the church as well. We will begin that on November 20th. Rob is very patiently waiting. So, Rob?
Thank you, Father. Good morning. My name is Rob Mustaris. I'm with the Knights of Columbus. Today we are hosting a to-go breakfast. All proceeds will benefit Coats for Kids. Developing weather patterns have many predicting a colder and wetter winter this year. The Seattle Weather Blog, as of October 19th, is forecasting 8 inches of snow this winter. Imagine being a child and not having a warm coat. Please consider stopping by the parish hall, picking up some breakfast, and helping to support efforts to put coats on kids. Thank you and God bless.
Thank you, Rob. The office is open after Mass. And thank you for all your donations. You can make a donation as you exit. The Lord be with you. And may Almighty God bless you all in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Mass is ended. Let us go in peace.
Our sending forth hymn is number 803. And we will sing verses 1, 2, and 3.